Thanks for coming tonight. Thanks for coming to the University of San Francisco. I'd also like to thank the Dean of the Business School, Mike Weber, and the Associate Dean, John Veach, for all their help in making these events possible. And I'd also like to thank Margot Fry and her team, Amy Pfeiffer, Michaela Hines, Jennifer Hogan, Patrick Stacey, and the entire film crew, and others that I may have forgot to mention. Before we begin, please turn off your cell phones so we don't get a strange interruption in the middle of the guest lecture. What we're going to do is our guest speaker will speak first, and then I'm going to start the Q&A at the end of that, where I'll ask him some questions. And after I've done that, it's open to the audience. And so everyone will get a chance to ask questions, so think of some good questions. Our guest speaker obtained his BS from Caltech and his PhD from Harvard. He is currently the Franco Modigliani Professor of Financial Economics at the MIT School, Sloan School. Our guest speaker is one of the giants in finance. In finance, we essentially have two theories of asset pricing. One is the CAPM, one is the APT, or otherwise known as the arbitrage pricing theory. Every investments textbook that you may have taken a class in investments will have a chapter on the APT. Guess what? Our guest speaker invented that model. Applications of the APT are everywhere in the private sector as well. Probably the greatest discovery in finance was the black-scholes option pricing model. A few years after it was discovered, another option model was invented. It was called the binomial option pricing model. This model was easier to use than black-scholes, and also it was more flexible. It's used everywhere in finance, from brokerage firms to investment banks to portfolio managers. Guess what? Our guest speaker invented that model. In corporate finance, you may have studied something to do with the incentive of managers and shareholders. It's known as the theory of agency. Guess what? Our guest speaker invented that model. Our guest speaker wasn't content simply to construct his ideas in the glass cage of academia. He actually has participated in the real world, including being the CEO of an option consulting firm and the co-founder of an investment advisory firm to aid investors with derivative usage. He was also a former director of General Re, Cref, and Freddie Mac. Steve, do you have something to tell us? Our guest speaker's contributions to finance are really amazing. But there is something that I personally think is even more impressive about Stephen Ross. It's his contribution to others. I'll give you two examples. When I started my first job, the head of our bank paid consultants $2 million to restructure our asset management group. I studied the changes and I wrote an internal memo that said it didn't make any financial sense. Needless to say, the head of our division and others attacked all my findings, saying it was nonsense. I was really young, kind of like some of you are, and I was a bit insecure. And I was about to give up. But before I did that, I called Steve Ross. I told him the whole story, and I'll never forget what Steve Ross said to me. He said, "You are right, Ludwig. The volatility is too high." With that, I stuck to my position. And by the way, they went ahead and did it anyway. And 3 years later, they closed the program because it failed miserably. Thank you, Steve. I'm not the only one that Steve has helped, though. Today, if you look at the leading academics in finance, they probably were Steve Ross's students. I'll give you some examples. Lawrence Kotlikoff, Nancy Stokey, John Campbell. He's the guy in that movie Inside Job. You remember that? Mark Grinblatt, Anat Damati, William Goetzman, and many, many others. His students were so grateful that they edited a book in his honor with their best papers, and they called it Steve Ross, a Mentor. Steve Ross signed a copy of this, and we're going to give it to the Business School of USF. I have to admit that when I looked at this book, I couldn't believe that all these people were his students. These are all famous guys in finance, and I couldn't believe it. So I called Steve up and said, "Steve, are they really your students, all of them?" And he replied, "Yes, Ludwig, I'm really, really old." Please give a warm welcome for Dr. Stephen Ross.
Can you hear me? It's like that ad for, trying to get this up. Ludwig, you can introduce me any time, Ludwig. That was quite delightful. I'm not sure I can see this. Can you see it? Yes, you can see it back there. So I'm going to talk about something that is very exciting for me. This is the first work I've done by myself. I tend to do a lot of papers with other people. But this is the first thing I've done by myself in about a dozen years. And I can't quite tell whether it's because other people didn't want to write it with me, or I just sort of thought it was an interesting idea and I wanted to do it by myself. A lot of what goes on in academics is selfish. If you have a good idea, you say, I'm not going to share it with anyone, I'm going to do it myself. So I think this is a very, very interesting idea. And I also think it's going to change a lot of what happens in practice. So you're amongst the first people to hear this. And at some stage, I'll give another talk about showing how to use it. But right now, it's just about what it is. It's called the recovery theorem. And basically what it does, it says that everything we've ever done in derivative theory, it's not wrong, it's just not very useful. This is a more useful way to do things. All right, let's see if that's true or not. Is there a way to make this bigger? I can't see. It's got this tiny little screen inside the big screen. The answer is no. Okay, well, I turn around like this. So what this is about is using prices in the marketplace to figure out what people in the marketplace are thinking. And in particular, can we take the prices we see in the marketplace and get some sense of what people think the expected return on the stock market is, or what they think the risk is going to be, or what they think the whole probability distribution is going to be, or what do they think the probability of a crash is going to be? And I always had this thought, you ought to be able to do this, but I spent a lot of time with a theory that says you can't. So let's see if we can change that view. Here's what we do now when we're trying to figure out what the world thinks is going to happen in the future. We look at history. So the generic approach for estimating the probability distribution of returns in the future, 1 year out, say, is to look at what it's been in the past. Years ago, I gave a talk, and I said this was the case, and someone said, well, Professor Ross, he said, don't you use any future data? You just use past data? I said, well, if someone gave me future data, I would use it, but I only have past data to use. So we use historical data. And we say, what happened in the past? So we ask ourselves questions like, what was the average return on stocks in the past? And we say that average return is the return we expect in the future. So we look at monthly returns, say 100 years of stock market data, take the average and say, that's a pretty good guess of what it's going to be next month. But none of us think it is. But we use it because it's sort of like we don't have anything else to use. We estimate the variance in the same way. So we just take the estimator, standard statistical estimator for the variance, and we use that. Sometimes we use something a little more advanced. We use the VIX. The VIX is a trademark name for a contract that trades volatility. It's a volatility contract, and so we get a VIX number, and that's supposed to be a forward-looking measure of what the variance is going to be. It's not quite, but it's supposed to be. And we apply these results for decision-making. And it's important, it's hard to underestimate, excuse me, let me go, oh, there it is, hard to underestimate how often and continuously this is used. I mean, in every shop in the world, every financial shop, if someone's sitting around trying to figure out what's the best amount to have in equities and what's the best amount to have in bonds, they have an estimate of the expected return on stocks and they plug it in. Sometimes for fixed income, they use the yield curve, something like that. But that's what we do. We use these numbers all the time. Here's my point. Here's the thing that always beguiled me. I don't understand this. We have stocks, we have options, we have bonds, and these things are some expectation of the cash payouts you're going to get in the future. And they're all summarized in today's price. So why can't we use that information to go backwards? Take the price and figure out what people were expecting. So this is what this talk is about. You can actually do that. So let's look at interest rates. Here's what we do in the fixed income markets. How many of you are not familiar with the yield curve? You see, you can always get 100% response if you ask the question right. If I ask it the other way, I'd get the same response probably. But you just look across the yield curve. You look at the prices of one-year bonds, the rates on one-year bonds, two-year bonds, three-year bonds, five-year bonds, and so forth. And from that curve, you know, long bonds today have higher rates than short bonds. The current short rate of interest is essentially zero, yet nothing. But out further, it's higher. And so you say, well, that's the market telling us that it expects interest rates to rise in the future. So if you look at the difference between, say, a three-year, one-month bond and a three-year bond, the difference in interest rates is the market's way of saying, that's what we think the one-month rate is going to be in 3 years. That's the difference. And so that's a forward rate, and people use it as a prediction, the market's prediction, a forecast for what the interest rate's going to be in 3 years. But it's not. And it's not because those interest rates, those forward rates and the prices of bonds have risk aversion baked into them. There's some sense that it's not just a perfect prediction. People are averse to risk. And if people are averse to risk, it's going to be biased. So they're going to want to have a lower price and a higher yield if they're going to invest for a longer time. That's one theory of that. Well, historical data is often used to estimate the risk premium, just as it is for equities. So we do something, at least in the forward, in fixed income, we have these bonds, and we try and disentangle from the bonds what we think interest rates are going to be in the future. Here's what we do in equity markets. This was one of the spurs for me in doing this. We don't ask anything. We do nothing. That's the easiest way to say it. We don't even ask the market to tell us what it thinks the S&P is going to be a year from now. Not that it knows, but just what does it think it's going to be? Here's what we do in equity markets. We use historical market returns, just as I said. We say history will repeat itself. We build a model. We use a dividend yield model. So we say if prices are high, let's say earnings are at a certain level, and prices are high historically compared to earnings, we say prices are going to come down. The price-earnings ratio is too high. It's going to come down to some historical average. So your returns going forward aren't going to be as high because prices are too high. It's a standard model people use. Here's the one that really got me. We survey people. Every single month, I get a call from someone saying, we'd like your views of what the market's going to do next month. I don't have a clue. You know, I suspect that no one who's asked has a clue. You know, and if I did know, I wouldn't tell some guy on the telephone. Yeah, if I really knew, I certainly wouldn't tell a guy. So, I mean, that's the state of what we do. We do something with prices, but these are sort of ad hoc. I won't even go into them. We just kind of say, well, prices are high, and so that means that people are optimistic. We say vague phrases like that. What we want to do is we really want to find out what's happening. We want to look at option prices. We want to look at stock prices. And options are a great place to look. So this is about much maligned derivative theory. Derivatives are really wonderful things. I mean, they are, unfortunately, we're on the verge of regulating them out of existence. That's a little strong. But they are so informative about the world. It would be a shame if they became less informative because there was less of them around. And you'll see that soon. If we could actually use these prices to tell us what people thought was in the future, it would open up so many different possibilities. There'd be so many things you could do with it. So what I'm going to do in this talk is show you how you can use them. Right? And I warn you ahead of time, there's a little algebra here, but not a lot. Right? I'm always loath to put algebra up on because the audience is very mixed. And whenever you do it, some people say, why doesn't he get on with it? That's so trivial. And other people say, what is he doing? You know, and so you will no doubt divide into two camps on this. So I'm going to look at options, derivatives options. I use them in the same way. So I'm thinking of puts and calls. And everything in my mind is the S&P 500 and I'm looking at the market on the S&P 500 options, and then I'll tell you about that in a little bit. So this is the binomial model. So don't shake your head yet, please. This is really very simple. All it says is that, let me go backwards. It says that I've got a simple model of how stock prices evolve over time. My model is really about as simple as you could imagine. So this is, you could think of it over a day. One of two things is going to happen in the next day. Tomorrow the price will be higher or it'll be lower. That's all that happens. Okay? And A is higher, so A is bigger than 1. So the stock is going to jump from its price today, S, to price AS, which is higher. Or it's going to drop from its price today, S, to a price BS that's lower. That's all that can happen. Okay? And the probability of it going up is F. And the probability it goes down is 1 minus F. That's all that happens. And at the end of a month, you've had 30 days of going up and down, and you can get to a lot of different places that way. So you could really pretty much capture what happens in a month by looking at little changes like this every day. On the right-hand side, you see that B is less than 1 plus the interest rate, R is the interest rate, and that's less than A. That has to be true. If 1 plus the interest rate, so you put a dollar in, and you get 1 plus R out, say R is 3%, you get 1.03 out. If that was always less than B, the worst case for the stock, stocks would dominate bonds. No one would ever invest in bonds. So that couldn't happen. And even better still, you'd borrow at the interest rate and invest all you could in stocks, and you'd make endless amounts of money because you could never lose. The same is true on the reverse side. You couldn't have the interest rate, the bond market, always do better than the stock market. So the only way to prevent that from happening is to have the interest rate, 1 plus the interest rate, lie just between the best result for the stock, A, and the worst result for the stock, B. Okay? And F is just the probability of a jump. This is the algebra. And I don't, you know, you don't really have to know this, but it is useful to see it. Oop. Well, there. Doesn't show up here. So P of A is 1 over 1 plus the interest rate times some formula. I don't care what the formula is. But the important thing about this is that it's the discounted value. So 1 over 1 plus the interest rate is the value of a dollar tomorrow. You're just discounting whatever you get in the future. And 1 plus R minus B over A minus B didn't come out right here. That's just a probability that you attach to it. And if you were to look at these things, the sum of the discounts, so PAA times plus PBB equals 1. Let me explain what this is. So P of A, I want the price of a security, not the stock, not the bond. I want to make a pure bet that the stock goes up. This is the price of an option that's going to pay me a dollar in the future, say a year from now, or whatever that time period, let's say it's a month. It's going to pay me a dollar a month from now if the stock goes up, and it's going to pay me nothing if it doesn't. And a little algebra gets you that that's what it is. And P of B is the reverse. It's a pure bet on the stock going down. I mean, if I were to short the stock, it wouldn't quite be as good a bet, you know, because I'd lose something if A happened. This is just a pure bet. So how much would it cost me? How much would I have to pay today if I were to bet that the stock's going to go down? And I'll get a dollar if the stock goes down. P of B is the price I'd pay today for that dollar. And P of A is the price I'd pay if I got a dollar when it goes up. What's P of A plus P of B? Any idea? Well, what have you bought? You've paid P of A for a dollar if the stock goes up and nothing if it goes down. P of B for a dollar if the stock goes down and nothing if it goes up. So you've paid P of A plus P of B and you've bought a dollar whether the stock goes up or down. That means you've got a sure bet. What do you pay for a sure bet? Just you're getting a dollar in the future for sure, so it's 1 over 1 plus the interest rate. Just the discounted value of a dollar for sure. So P of A, if you worked out the algebra, P of A plus P of B would add up to 1, 1 over 1 plus R. And also it turns out that P of A times A plus P of B times B equals 1. That just says that the return you get on the stock is A if it goes up and B if it goes down. So if you pay, if the A is what you get if it goes up, P of A is what it's worth today. And if B is what you get if it goes down, P of B is what it's worth today. So if you add them up, you get the dollar, because a dollar is how much you put into the stock. Right? So it's really kind of straightforward what these things are. It just takes a little time. Let's look a little bit. I won't say that. This just says any security, D, that pays you D of A if the stock goes up and D of B if it goes down, its value today is just this price of A times D of A plus the price of B times D of B. Yeah. Whenever anything goes up, its value, every dollar it goes up, is worth P of A to you, and similarly P of B. So if you just add those two up, you're going to get the price today of this derivative. This is a very simple theory. This is the theory that's used in all the derivatives markets. So when Ludwig was saying they use it at the banks, this is what they use in all the banks. This is a very simple way of doing things. But it's extraordinary, this formula. And you should notice how extraordinary it is, because when I go backwards and I look at P of A and P of B, I'll ask you a question, what isn't there? F. Where's the F? There's no F there. But F is the probability the thing goes up. So how could the value of something that has a probability of going up? So F is the probability that the stock is going to go up. How could some instrument that pays you if it goes up, how could its price not depend upon its value today, not depend on the probability that goes up? Well, that's the magic of this theory. The hardest thing to estimate is the probability that this is going to go up or down. That's the hardest thing to estimate. And the theory is beautiful in the sense that it says you don't need to know that. Amazingly, you don't need to know that. So this is the first example. This is the, can you hear? Yeah. This is the first example of a rabbit going in the hat. So a rabbit went in the hat. Now I'm just going to take the rabbit out. So the rabbit went in the hat when I told you there was a bond and a stock. Because I can combine the bond and the stock to exactly copy any instrument that I want. I can just create a portfolio of the bond and stock that will replicate anything. And to do that, I just need to know the price of the bond and the price of the stock. I don't need to know the probability that the stock is going to go up. So it's really quite remarkable. If you had three things that it could do, it wouldn't work. Well, with just two things, it does work. That's the theory, and you don't even have to understand that theory to know that's the theory we have. And that theory has the wonderful result that you don't have to know this probability. Let's look at it a little further. So the formula is correct. I mean, it's been tested 100,000 times. And if it wasn't correct, a lot of people would make a lot of money by saying it's wrong. So I really trust that when people have money at stake, they find out if it's wrong. So it's not wrong, it's right. Right? And a little time and effort, you would figure out the logic of this. It's correct even though we don't know what the stock probability is going to be. But the converse of that is a real killer. We don't know the probability that it'll go up. We don't need to know the probability to see the price of these options. But if that's the case, we can't use the price of the options to figure out the probability. It's the sad converse side of the same thing. You don't need the probability to figure out the price, but unfortunately then, if you know the price, you can't figure out the probability. Right? So that's what we're going to challenge here. So let me go. This is black-scholes. This is a page no one can love unless you've seen it before and you like it. Oh, look, it all came out funny in this thing. I can't describe, I don't know why it came out. So this is some different program that made it funny, but if you look, that's the Black-Scholes equation. That's a partial differential equation. This is only loved by physicists and mathematicians. That's the solution, the famous Black-Scholes solution for the price of a call option. You don't need to know this. All you need to know is it's the same as the one we did before. This is just the binomial. All you got to do is take the binomial and let those steps get smaller and smaller, and it'll converge to this. And you know what this says? Just as the probability didn't show up in the first equation, what doesn't show up here is the expected return on the stock. You don't need to know the expected return on the stock to figure out the price of a call option on a stock. You'll get the same expected return for two stocks that have entirely different expected returns. Two stocks have different expected returns. If they have the same variance, they're going to give you the same price of an option, exactly the same one. So we can't possibly figure out from this theory what the expected return on the stock is. But we want to be able to do that. I want to be able to do that. So I don't like this theory. I'm going to change the theory. So this is the blessing and the curse. The blessing is the expected return on a stock is what I'm trying to figure out. It's the hardest thing in the world to find. I estimate it in 1,000 different ways, and I get 1,000 different answers. I do it forward-looking. I do it historically. I never get the same answer. That's what I'd like to find out. And it doesn't matter. I get the same option price no matter what it is. And so as a consequence, it's really nice that I don't need it, but it's terrible because if I had the option price, I'd like to be able to go backwards and figure out what the return is. This whole theory began when we didn't have a lot of options. So all we had was stocks and bonds, and we were trying to create options from those, derivatives from those. And so we had those, and we tried to create, and we wanted a price for them. We live in a different world today. We have prices of options of all sorts. So this is the options market we live in today. So I'm just going to talk about the simplest one. We have puts and calls. So a put option is really simple. A put option is a contract that pays you, let's say it's an at-the-money put. So it pays you money if the stock goes below a certain strike price K. Right? So it could be at the money, it could be K, whatever. But say I have an option, so the market's about 1,500 today. Suppose I buy a 6-month put with a strike of 1,300. You own that put. If the market goes below 1,300, if it goes to 1,200, you get the difference, 100. A put option protects you against it going down. It's insurance against it going down. And if it doesn't go down to 1,300, it's worthless. 6 months from now, you get nothing. So you buy this option. The price is, you know, the market's at 1,500 today. It's going to pay you if the option gets below the strike price. It's an insurance contract. What it is, it's insurance with a deductible. There's a $200 deductible on it. Right? It's at 1,500 today. If it gets below the deductible of 200, gets to 1,300 or below, it'll pay you everything below that. But you've got to pay the first 200, the deductible. And a call option's the reverse. You make money if the stock goes up with a call option. So you have a strike of, say, let's say it's 1,700. So you get to pay $1,700 6 months from now. If the stock's at 1,800, you've made a $100 difference. If the stock's not 1,700, you won't pay the money and it's worthless. So it's an option that pays you off if it goes above the strike. And the put pays you off if it goes below the strike. Right? So let's look a little closely at these things. So the markets use the black-scholes formula, that messy thing, to price these options, or more precisely to quote option prices. So no one in the market really uses the formula to figure out what the option price should be. But they quote it that way. So an input into the Black-Scholes formula is something called the implied volatility. So you ask yourself, this is the price of the call option or the put option. What number do I have to plug into that formula to get that price? And then you plot that number out as a function of how long the maturity of the option is. Is it a 1-year option, a 2-year, a 5-year option? And what's the strike? Is the strike at 1,500, 1,700? 2,500, 1,300, 1,200, so. So you have a surface of these things. You can plot it out that way. No one actually uses it. It's just a way to quote the prices. And that's the volatility surface. In my business, I stare at that thing continuously. My wife's told me that I look at it more than I look at the pictures of my grandchildren, which is possibly true. Right? It's a really kind of an interesting picture here. I guess I'm going to have to go over to it. Let me go. Can you see that one? Okay. I could do both at once, but my arms aren't long enough. So as you go further out this way, those are longer options. As you go away from you, that's the longer dated options. And if you look close at the axis near you, 100% would be an option at 1500, the current price. And 80% would be a 20% out of the money put. So that's a put with a $300 deductible or a $1,200 strike. Okay? So puts are out of the money to the left, and they're very in the money to the right. Okay? So that's the volatility surface, and you know, it's hard to picture what it does, but I'll make it easy for you. Imagine that it just started as a flat plane, just perfectly flat, and had no curvature or anything. Pick up the end. So you just make it go up a little bit at the end, and you can see that it sort of sends rise at the end. And then take this corner over here and pull it up, and then it will look just like that. Okay? Going out that way is a function of tenor. So longer dated options just generally seem to cost more than short dated options. I think that's really a reflection of demand and supply, along with some expectations. So there's kind of an expectation that these volatilities are going to rise over time. But more importantly, there's a whole class of institutional investors that buy this stuff at the long end. Insurance companies sell variable annuities that promise to pay you if the market goes up. So to protect themselves against the variable annuities they've purchased, they want to buy some long-dated options. They're always in the market buying these. So that makes that tend to go up a little bit. And what's that thing at the left? Why does it go up like that? That's called the skew. So a really out-of-the-money put has a big price. Think of these as prices. That says it's a high price to buy a put with a big deductible on it. You're going to pay a lot of money for that. Why? Well, the price of a put or anything else is really just these three things. It's the discount rate, because you're going to get paid 6 months from now or a year from now or 2 years from now, so you have to discount it. It's how risk averse you are, and it's the probability of a put of a crash. What's the probability that it's going to go 30% down? My thing is at 1500. What's the probability that it'll drop 450 or more in the next year, say? If you think there's a high probability that it's going to drop 450 or more, if the market thinks that, then there's going to be a high price on the put. Suppose you don't think there's that high a probability, but you're really afraid that it might. You're very risk averse. If you're very risk averse, the put will have a high price. The discount rate doesn't matter. It's just set by interest rates. Okay? So the unfortunate thing is that what we're trying to do is figure out how risk-averse people are and the probability of a crash, but which is it? If I'm trying to figure out a crash probability, is the high price of a put that I see today, suppose it's higher today than it was a year ago, is that because people think there's a higher probability of a crash now than they did a year ago, or is it because they're really scared? And actually, there are times in history where you can separate the two out. So, Katrina. So when Katrina hit New Orleans, the property and casualty companies lost a ton of money. It was a huge loss for them. In fact, it came close to bankrupting a couple of the smaller ones that hadn't reinsured enough. But they smiled for the next 5 years. They made tons of money after that. Why? Because insurance premiums for flood protection went through the roof. Flood insurance just escalated. I mean, premiums went to 4 and 5 times what they had been in that area. Why? Well, you can have a lot of faith in global warming, but all the statistics say that if you had a hurricane this year, you don't have a higher chance of having one next year. The probability of a hurricane didn't change at all. So what did change? People really didn't like it when it had happened, and they didn't want it to happen again, and they were really afraid, and that's risk aversion. People were really averse to the risk. So that was a natural experiment where you could see that the put prices, this insurance rose, not because people had a higher probability of a hurricane occurring. Now, that's not to say I know that for sure. I don't. I mean, even though scientists tell us that the chance of a hurricane happening is any higher next year than it is this year, than it was just because we had one hurricane, doesn't mean that people really believe it. So I can't tell you what people really believe. But if they follow science, they should have believed that. I can tell you what they should have done. But I don't know what they actually did. So I have a really hard time, even with a natural experiment like that, disentangling how risk-averse they are from the probabilities. But that's what I want to do. That's my game. I want to figure out what is the probability of a crash. And I've got to separate it from risk aversion. And the question is, how can I do it? And I can't do it with a binomial model, and I can't do it with a black-scholes model. So I'll give you a model that you can do it with. So this is a new model, and this is a way to do this. And you know, I find it, as I said, find it very exciting that I can actually look at these prices and do it. And go back to that figure. Here's the beguiling thing. I have that surface that goes out, and it's got all these strikes. So it says what will happen if the market goes up 30% or down 30%. And it says how people think about it a year from now, and 2 years, and 5 years. All that information about the future is captured here in this surface. I think the models are misleading us. They're not as good as they should be. We have better models that we can use to disentangle those forecasts. So we're going to do that. Now, this is just complicated notation, none of which I use. But it describes the basics of the model. So this is a model in which you move by month to month from one state to the next. So states are just descriptions of everything you need to know to tell you what the future will be. Everything you would use to predict the future. It might be that the stock market's now at 1550. It might be that volatility is this. It might be the past history that got us here. Anything you want to use, that's in a state. And this is a model that says there's some probability of going from state I to state J, and I don't know what those probabilities are. But that's how the world moves. Every month it goes from one state to another. Just keeps bouncing through states. I don't know how it does it. I just know that that's what it's doing. And here's something else I do know. I have these prices, and I'll get them. I'll show you how to get them from options. I know the price that I would pay today if I was in state I for a dollar if state J occurred, just like I gave you the PA and the PB. I told you, you're here today. This is the price you'd pay today for a dollar if the stock went up in A, and a dollar if the stock went down in B. And that's what I do here. I know all those prices. And I got to convince you that I can find those prices. That's a little harder. So I'm going to show you how you do it, I mean, how you get those prices from options. And my goal is to use those prices to find F. I want to find the real probability that something will go. I want to look at the prices and figure out the probability. Right? Like in that binomial thing, I want to figure out F from these prices. And I can't do it there. I showed you couldn't do it there. So I'm going to make that a little different, enrich it a little bit so I can do it. And what I'm going to look at the simplest possible world. I'm going to look at a world with only two states in it. I can do it for a lot of states, but I'm just doing it for two. Okay? And just think of it this way. The world's in a good place or a bad place. We're either, it's a good state or a bad state. And so my probabilities that I need to know is if I'm in a bad state, what's the chance I stay there? What's the chance I get to a good state? And if I'm in a good state, what's the chance I stay there? What's the chance I deteriorate to a bad state? So all I'm trying to figure is those four things, those four probabilities. So what do I know? I only have two probabilities. I have the probability that if I'm in the good state A, I stay in A. Because the probability that if I'm in the good state and I deteriorate to B is just one minus that, right? Because the probability is that it's got to go somewhere. It either stays in A or it goes to B. And if I'm in the bad state B, what's the chance I stay there? Call it FB. And what's the chance that I go to a better state? One minus that. Okay? So there's only two things, there's only two probabilities I need to know. The chance that I stay in A if I'm in A, or the chance that I stay in B if I'm in B. Because what's left over is the chance that I move from those. Okay? And contingent prices are given by a simile unappealing matrix. I guess the way to think about that is that P with an arrow AA, that's the price of a dollar in A if I'm in A today, and P with an arrow AB is the price of a dollar if I'm in A and I go to B. That's how much I'd pay to protect myself against going to B, and similarly for PB and PA. Okay? So four prices, and I know those four prices. And I got to figure out those two probabilities. There's a couple other things I have to figure out. I have to know the risk aversion. Because remember I said it was risk aversion time. So there's a risk aversion if you're in A and a risk aversion if you're in B. Okay, that's two more unknowns I need to have. So I got four things. Yeah, it's getting a little hard. Let's keep going. So this is what you have. So PIJ, that's the price of going from state I to state J. I got four of those because there's two states, A and B. So I go AA, AB, BA, BB. So I have four of those. And then I have the risk aversion. It's delta, that's just the discount rate. That's the time rate of discount, times the risk aversion in J divided by the risk aversion in I times those probabilities. Well, there are four equations. And the bottom line here is there are four equations and five unknowns. Remember your algebra? So you have four equations and five unknowns. But you can actually find all five because it's not a simple, it's a quadratic. So it turns out that you can just manipulate these equations and you get a quadratic. It has a unique solution and you can find all the things you want to know. And more generally, if you have 100 states, so you break the world into 100 states, you can actually take all those 100 states and all the information you have in option prices, you can get all the prices you need to know, and you can reverse it and figure out all the probabilities. What's different about this from black-scholes? What's different about this from the binomial? Think of the binomial model. So the binomial, you were sitting here today, the stock was worth S, and it was going to go up or down. And you had a price if it went up. That's the price of a dollar if it goes up. How much you'd pay today for a dollar, getting payoff when it goes up. And the price that you would pay today for a dollar if it goes down. So that's two prices and you know them. But you have four unknowns. You have the discount rate, you don't know that. You have the two risk aversions, you don't know that. And you have the probability that it goes up or down. Right? Four unknowns, two equations, there's no way to do that. Even the magic that gets you a solution with five and four doesn't work here. So the magic here is that I said the probability of going up wasn't fixed, it wasn't F. It depended on whether you were already up, whether you were in a good state now. Or another way to put it is, if you're, maybe the states are indexed by whether you came to where you are. Maybe it's a difference. If I'm currently at 1550, did I get here because the market rose up to 1550? Or did I get here because it fell from 1700 down to 1550? Maybe I have to report that. That's part of my state. And if it came from the bottom up to 1550, then the chance that it'll go up in the future is different than if it fell from 1700 to 1550. Once I allow for that, I get extra equations and I can solve this. So that's the change that we make in that model. And it's a simple analytic change, but it has really quite strong implications. So those are my five unknowns. The four, two risk aversions, phi A and phi B, the two probabilities, F A and F B, and that delta, just the discount rate. And I can solve for them. So here's what we're actually going to do. This is the fun part. We're going to apply it. We're going to actually go do it. So I'm going to tell you what the market thinks it's going to do in the future. Right? So I'm going to actually recover everything. I'm going to recover those probabilities. And I picked an arbitrary but interesting date. It took me almost 4 months to do these computations for one day. So we have a group working on this now to do them and present them a history of all these results to show you how it would actually work in the past. Okay? But we can't do it yet. We're struggling to do this. So I use option prices to get those PAs and PBs. And then I use those to find those contingent prices. The price, if I'm in state I, of going to state J. How much I'd pay for a dollar in state J if I'm now in I. And then lastly, I apply this recovery theorem, and I get out the risk aversion and the probabilities. So now I'll show you how I get the prices. So I won't go through it in detail. We're getting to the end here. So the way to think about this is You ever hear about a butterfly spread? People trade butterfly spreads in the market. So suppose I take a call option at 1570, and I buy a call option at 1570. And then I sell two call options at 1571. And then I buy one at 1572. The payoff on that will look like this. It'll be a little triangle between 1570 and 1572 with a peak of 1571. In other words, that combination pays off if and only if the market is right between 1570 and 1572. That's exactly what I'm looking for. I'm looking for something that pays off only when the market's in a certain range and doesn't bid me anything outside that range. That's what I'm looking for. And so I figured all those out from market prices. And it's tricky. This data is OTC data, over-the-counter data, not exchange-traded data. And you want OTC data because the OTC market, the over-the-counter market, is about 7 times larger than the exchange-traded market. And the liquidity is much larger. It's a much richer market. You get that whole surface. If you're on the exchange, you just get a little triangle of it. Those are the prices, and that's the picture. The picture is much nicer than the prices. So way in the back there at 0.25, that's looking one quarter out. And those, that graph is how much you would pay for a dollar at these different strikes here. So how much would you pay for a dollar in the neighborhood of the market not moving over the next quarter? You'd pay a lot of money for that. Because the likelihood that in a short period of time, like a quarter, it's going to go very far away is pretty small. So the most of the chances are that you're going to be close to where you are today. So you'll pay the most for that. And you'll pay the less for being further away, way at the back there. And then as you come closer to you, you're looking at things years out. Like the closest one there is 2 3/4 years out. So 2 3/4 years from now, the prices have sort of flattened out. Because in 2 3/4 years, the chance that you'll move away from zero is getting pretty high. You're not going to stay where you are. 2, 3, 4, 5 years from now, you're going to drift away somewhere. And so you're prepared to pay a fair amount, higher prices here, for the chance that the market will be between 30 and 35% up or down. So you just pay more. So in the market of derivatives, you can get these prices. You can figure out how much it costs you to make a bet on the market going up. You can figure out all the put prices. What it costs you for all the stuff below 20% down. What's the chance of a crash? Or what's the price of a crash? Right. Well, the next step is to figure out those contingent probabilities. And this is the picture that helps you do it. Suppose we're, what I really want to know is how much would I pay for a dollar if the market was at 1450, if the market's now at 1200? Even though the market isn't at 1200, today the market's at 1500, 1550. Okay, let's use, I said 1300. That tells you roughly when this paper, this graph was first drawn. 2 years ago I'd first drew this thing. So if the market's at 1300, I know today how much I'd pay from those little triangles, those little butterfly spreads. I know how much it would cost me to get a dollar a year from now if the market's at 1450 or near 1450. What I want to figure out is how much would I pay in one quarter if the market wasn't at 1300, if it was at 1500 today. If it was at 1500, how much would I pay for 1450? Well, 1450 is closer to 1500, so I expect it to be a higher price, right? And it's down, so risk aversion to make it higher. But how much would I pay for it? Well, how do I get from 1300 to 1450? I have to go through something at the end of the third quarter. It got to 1450 by going through 1600 or 1500 or 1400. It's all the different possibilities. So what's the price today of going from 1300 to 1450? How much do you pay to get to 1450? Well, you'd pay the price you take to get to 1600 times getting from 1600 to 1450, plus the price of going to 1500 times 1500 to 1450. So you just have a whole bunch of equations. You add them all up, and that's a bunch of equations and the things you want to know. 1600 to 1450, 1500 to 1450. You want to know all those things. And so you got a bunch of equations in that. And now I'm going to change all these prices. I'm going to change from 1450, I'm going to change it to 1500 and 1600. Then I got a whole bunch more equations. And then I'm going to do it for a bunch of different quarters. When I'm all done, I have enough equations to find it. I can actually find all those prices I'm looking for. So I can now have those contingent prices. Even though I'm living today with the price of 1550, I can figure out what the price would be if it wasn't 1550 today, if it was 1200 today. I can tell you what the price of a dollar a quarter from now, if the price was 1200 today, what that price would be for a dollar at 1450. So I can figure all those things out. Once I've got all this, I can actually do the analysis. At least that's the theory. So let's apply the recovery theorem. These are the results. So bootstrapping is just history. I just take random draws from history. That's just what you get historically. Historically, the chance of a 32% drop 6 months out is 0.08%, 0.00008. The market thinks it's closer to 1%. If you look here at cumulative probabilities, what's the chance of a drop of 26% or more? Well, in the market, it's 0.002% or 0.02%. In the recovered, it's 0.2%. In the recovered, it's 2%. So the market thought there was a 10 times higher chance of a crash in April. This was April 27, 2011. Than we would have thought from history. People were more nervous? No, because I took the nervousness out. This is just the probability that the market had that it was going to crash. Let's look at the difference between history and looking forward at that date. So the green is looking forward, and the blue is history. I think that's right. Yeah, the green is recovered. So what's the difference between these two? So that's the distribution across the different possibilities in the market, looking forward with this as opposed to history. So what does history tell you? Well, look at the left-hand tail, a really low chance that you're going to have a crash, another crash. What did the market think? A lot higher. The green was higher. What about in the middle? What's the chance that you'll have a modest increase, or stay close to zero? The green is higher than the blue. Well, you can't always have one chance be higher than the other. So where do you pay for it? The green is lower than the blue in the top end. So the recovered chance, the market thinks the probability of a big increase is lower at that time than history would have suggested. Now, I'm not telling you that the market's right and history is wrong. I can't do that. I'm just telling you that's what the market thought. It thought at the time that the chance of a big rise was lower, you know? And that's 2011, 6 months out. You know, to tell the truth, I can't even remember what happened in the next 6 months. I don't know if it went up or down, but it wouldn't matter because it's just one observation. So what I need to do is do this for every single day in the past where I have the data. I can, in theory, go back about 12 years. So I can tell you every day in the past, I can tell you, on that day, what did the market think was going to happen a month from then, 2 months, 6 months, a year, 5 years out? I can do that every single day. And I want to look and see, were they right? Were they wrong? Did they get it right? Did they get it wrong? What's happening going forward? Is the market being validated? Or for those of you in the bond markets, is it like the bond market, where you have a yield curve and you think you're going to be rising up, but you never rise up? The thing seems to slide along, you know? So you never really go up the yield curve. Maybe that's happening here too. I just don't know. And I won't know till I do it. But I do know it's really exciting to do this, to have a different way of doing something, and something that's a forward-looking way. So what I intend to do is two things. First, I've got a group working, and we're trying to get we have very nice data. We're trying to produce these predictions every single, at least to start monthly, for the past decade, past 10, 12 years. So I'll produce these, a prediction from this, every single month for that long period of time, right, going forward every month. And then I'll make it available to people who want to do research with it. But of course, I'll sell it too. So that's everything for my talk. And I, by the way, I should say one other thing. If this works, it's going to be really exciting and healthy. So I won't get calls anymore from people saying, what do you think the market will do? I'd say, subscribe to my service and you'll be able to figure it out. Okay. Thank you very much.
Steve, you invented the arbitrage pricing theory, but you never told us which factors to use and how many there are.
And I won't now either. It's not quite true. I think of the theory as kind of a template. So I was sort of agnostic about what the different factors would be, and I thought a lot of good empirical work were going into figuring them out, and I wrote a paper with Naifu Chen and Dick Roll in which we said, here are some obvious candidates. Interest rates, inflation, you know, some obvious usual suspects for what it could be. And it turned out to do pretty well, and there seem to be a lot of folks who continue to do those kinds of studies. But it's not a complete theory. It doesn't really say this is what the factors are that drive the market. It's just kind of a meta theory that says you have some good factors, you can put them in.
Okay, thanks. Can you tell us a little bit, you talked about the binomial model today. Can you tell us a little bit about how you, John Cox, Mark Rubenstein, came up with the model? And were there any juicy stories that you can tell us?
There were juicy ones, but not ones I can tell. So, but there were some good stories. We were working at the time, and as you can see, I like little pictures. And so I had a little picture, and thing goes up and things go down. You know, it was really kind of simple. And did you really need to have... And at the time, by the way, there was a lot of debate about it's because it's diffusions and it's continuous and it's this math. There's a deep mathematical artillery that got you there. And I said, you know, it's funny. It seemed to work if it was just up or down. And so that was, he said, if the stock can only go up and down and you have a bond that has a fixed interest rate, then you could combine the stock and the bond to give you those pure securities. And it just that's just how it started, you know. And there were some eureka moments. I remember when John and I were talking, and this was a different paper, an earlier one where we figured out this thing about how you could price things by just using the interest rate. You didn't have to know the expected return or the probability. And we said, you know, how can that be? And we said, well, if you can price the thing, if one combination of the bond and the stock is the same as the option, then it's going to be the same for everybody. It's going to be the same no matter what their preferences are. And so it's certainly going to work for someone who has just an expectation. So it worked for them. And it did. So that was how we got it. There were the only eureka moment was writing with John Cox is a very tortured experience. My wife said at one time that if I did it again, she would divorce me. Because John is a wonderful thinker and a very deep fellow. But he's extremely precise. Nothing, you know, I'm much sloppier than John. So I remember driving up with another co-author, John Ingersoll, driving to Boston, and we were gonna stop and see John. And so we told John that if he didn't release the paper and send it, it had been accepted, but he just wouldn't finish it. Just revisions, you know. That if he didn't release it, we were gonna steal his son, Jonathan. You know, so that didn't work either. You know? But eventually we got it out of him. But when you write things with people, it doesn't matter whether it's research or anything else. People's different styles sort of impinge upon you. You know, you just sort of you get to know someone really well, and sometimes you wish you hadn't. But in this case, I was glad I did.
Back to asset pricing. We have two models. They both have problems. What do you think is missing from asset pricing models today? And do you think a better one will come along, or it's too difficult because of the diversity of agents, et cetera?
I don't think the diversity of agents has, but I think it's a work in progress. Gene Fama has a wonderful comment about this, and I can do no better than Gene. Gene said, the data has yet to meet a theory that it likes. Yeah. it's unfortunate but true. We have good theories with good intuitions, but they're not good enough. They don't seem to really capture everything that's going on. And as a consequence, rather than looking for better theories, we spend an awful lot of time just sort of jury-rigging what we have. So for those of you in this literature, the theory says expected returns depend upon betas. You got a beta that tells you the expected return. But now we know that momentum seems to have a role in stock markets. So stocks that have gone up tend to go up some more. Now, it's a little funny thing. I mean, it's one of those statistical things you find. So it's not just that it went up over the past year. It has to have gone up for the 11 months prior to the last month. You know, and it always reminded me a little bit of, you know, if you stare at the clouds long enough, you know, you see bunnies and squirrels and you see all this funny stuff up there. It's not there, it just starts to look like that to you. If you, or another phrase that's even more adept, if you look at this data enough, I had a Turkish friend. We were sitting at a seminar, an academic seminar once, and this fellow was going through this extraordinarily complicated and turgid description of some model and some results, and we were just hanging by a thread and didn't have a clue what they were saying. And Ulan, my friend, turned to me and said, we have a saying in Turkish, he said, if you torture the data long enough, it will confess to any crime. You know? And that's what we were watching, and I think some of this stuff is just data mining, data torturing, you know. But some of it seems to have content too, so I'd like to see better theory.
Okay.
Okay. I had a suggestion. I think we ought to take away the statistical and econometric license from all the people doing this work. And they should spend 5 years just sitting on their hands so people who do theory can catch up and, you know, figure out what's really going on, because there's just too much stuff to figure out now.
Okay, what is one of the most interesting applications that you saw of one of your contributions?
I'm sort of always surprised by what people do. And it's always fun, you go around the world and see people doing different things. So I saw some fellows who were doing microfinance in Peru and in Colombia and some of the South American countries. And they were using the binomial model to figure out the price of insurance on coffee crops as a function of the weather. And I thought that it was just really kind of interesting to see that it had that kind of use, you know. In the end, it gives me some heart, because there's an awful lot of discussion today about how we don't need all these people going into finance. This is less going in now. We don't need all these people going into finance. They should be socially productive. They should go into computer science, or they should become engineers, or doctors, or something like that. Well, I don't believe that at all. I mean, you know, all the people at MIT who go into computer science wind up working building computer games. I mean, social media. You explain to me why that's more socially productive than figuring out how to insure crops in Colombia or something. I don't believe it. You know, That was the most useful thing, one of the most interesting things.
Okay, well, two more, and then we'll open to the audience. What do you think the greatest misconception about investing is?
Someone once said, every individual thinks that there are four great investors in the world. Everyone thinks that. There's Warren Buffett, there's Peter Lynch, there's George Soros, and themselves. So everyone overestimates their ability to do it. You know, and I've done it for many, many years, and I can tell you it's wickedly hard, you know, because it's just extremely difficult. And it gets even more difficult when people say, you're not doing as well as that other person, because you're in a game. It's a competition, and it's a zero-sum game. So everyone's not going to do better than the average, and so you're always going to look bad at some times and good at other times. But I will say, I never met a successful investor that's not true. I've met a couple. Very few ascribe their success to luck. They all have these wonderfully elaborate theories about how smart they are and how well they did. You know? I don't believe it. There's a huge amount of luck going on in the business.
Okay, last question. What do you think could be done to teach finance or business better at university?
More use of my textbook. I think we actually do a pretty darn good job of doing it. You know, I think, and there is a nice division that's growing over time too. So, you should be learning the things in school that are the basic principles you need to bring to the business world, and then when you get to the business world, you learn what they actually do there, and those are two separate things. I don't know a successful trader, and I know a lot of traders who don't believe that markets are very efficient, for example. So when you learn efficient markets, you know, you have this view that somehow, well, that's an academic theory and the real world isn't. Look at these people making all this money. You talk to the successful traders, saying a market is efficient is just a way of saying how damn difficult it is to make money in the market. They all have some belief in efficient markets. That doesn't mean they don't think they can have an edge sometimes or there's clever things they can do. They do. And that's how the market gets more efficient. So these principles that you learn, I would just say if I was going to do it better, I would try and spend more time on the theory, more time on the principles, more time on the fundamentals. And then when people go to work, they figure out what's actually happening, you know, which isn't different. It's just a way, the fundamentals are a way of organizing what you're seeing in the real world. Okay?
Thank you. Let's open it up.
So if you have a question, please raise your hand and I'll bring you the mic.
Thank you, Dr. Russ, for joining us. So the question I have is about your discussing the option surface. And I'm going to discuss gold or ask a question related to gold. We've had some disturbance with the gold pricing, and there's an ETF that trades gold, GLD. Also, several
the
years
ago. The largest ETF around.
Absolutely.
It's a huge, humongous ETF.
Similarly, back in 2010, May, we had an enormous drop in value of the S&P 500 that no one, to the best of my knowledge, has ever explained. The question I wanted to ask is that volatility surface that you describe where people pay a lot, say, for put options. They'll pay a lot for nearby contracts, then it seems to fall off, and then it rises again with these back-ended institutional investors. So there's almost like a smile. I think I've heard that
a saddle.
Okay, whatever. Is there anything predictive in that surface when we get these extraordinary price movements on whether it be gold or the stock market? Is there anything in the surface of options that gives us information to avoid getting burned?
I have... My feeling is yes. I'll know for sure when I finish the work on this, because this is a way of extracting what the market. And will we be able to predict, you know, flash crashes and things like that? I doubt it. But I think we will be able to do some predicting. So when the market was in its infancy, before the crash in 87, so if, you know, I was running money at the time and we had a pretty big business in equities at the time, and I'm looking at that market and I'm seeing it just going straight up. You know, it just keeps going up. You know? And it seemed divorced from anything that I thought made sense, but it was going up. But then I looked at option prices. You know, a typical volatility is 25% a year, 20% a year, something like that. In the week before the crash, the volatility on the options that you could see traded was at 90%. 90% a year. So we called clients and we said, something big is going to happen. I don't know if it's going to be big good or big bad. Yeah. But I think it's probably not going to be all that good. But we didn't predict the crash. We certainly couldn't predict that. But the market was, you know, those prices were telling you that something big was going to happen. And then you had your own judgments as to what it was going to be. So I do think there's an awful lot of predictive content in these prices, and I just can't with confidence tell you how much yet. Right? But if I come back in a year, I'll tell you how much. Okay. I hope I have to give a talk in 3 weeks in which I'm supposed to tell you how much. And I'm praying that we're done by then. I don't know.
Next question.
So this isn't so much related to the presentation, but Professor Chincarini, he mentioned quite a few of your students have gone on to be very successful, sort of prominent people in the finance world. And I was just wondering if you could sort of engineer or create the prototypical finance student, what types of qualities would you put in them?
It would be a student that I wouldn't pick. My ability to pick good people, I've been really quite lucky, okay? My ability to tell you who will do well isn't all that high. So at MIT now, in the PhD finance program, we have between 400 and 500 applications every year. And we take between 3 and 5 people. They all have common characteristics. Whatever country they came from, they were first in the country in the national mathematics exam, first in the national physics exam. They won the concert pianist competition. They do all these wonderful things. And then they come and they don't do that well. Sometimes they do very well, but it's rare when they do well. You'd think with all that background, they'd do great. Right? And over the years, the best students I've had were some of the most unusual ones. So someone said my failures don't become professors, they become billionaires. So an Israeli paratrooper who got a PhD at Yale with me, it's worth a huge amount of money. Some of these people became greatly wealthy, and yet they didn't do all those amazing things when they were young. And some of the people who became great professors were really quite weak at mathematics. How could someone be weak at mathematics and be good at this subject? And I didn't understand. So one of my great students is Will Getzman. I think he mentioned Will. Ludwig mentioned Will. So Will graduated in art history from Yale. And he went to he wound up being the curator of the American wing of the Denver Museum. And while he was there, his wife was an architect and they came to New Haven so he could do more. While he was there, he wrote a book called The West of the Imagination, The American West Through the Eyes of Artists Who Painted It. And he and his father co-authored a Nova series that got a Pulitzer. That's not bad credentials, but it certainly isn't a high-tech math guy. So he came to Yale and he took my course and he was the first guy to figure out, he was an MBA, he was the first guy to figure out how to actually measure the impact on a stock of being included in something like the S&P index or not. And he found this natural experiment. He said when the telephone company was broken up, 8 companies were created, all of which were so big that they had to be in the S&P. So they had to drop 8 out at the bottom. And if they dropped the smallest 8 companies at the bottom, they were all electric utilities. And so you'd have almost no electric utilities in the S&P. So he said, no, they're not going to do that. So he found 20 companies that were small that were candidates to be dropped. And he followed them, and when they broke AT&T up, it was announced it was going to break, when they started to trade those stocks, they dropped 8 of those 20 out. And you know what happened? The 8 they dropped out on that day dropped by 2%. The 12 that stayed in, they each went up about 1%, because everyone breathed a sigh of relief and said they weren't dropped. Right? So it was really kind of a fascinating, he had that capacity to build these natural experiments. He's gone on to write wonderful things about the market for art, as you'd expect. And are art prices really the prices of assets? And do they follow a capital asset pricing model? And he looked at hedge fund fees. He said managers of hedge funds have a bias because they get this nice performance fee. So he did all sorts of clever, interesting work that had nothing to do with being a really good mathematician. So I tell you, I don't know who's going to be good. But after you spend a little time with people, if they're really fun to talk to and they have a broad set of interests, you get more comfortable they're going to do good work. So that's the best I can do. Right? That's a wonderful thing, by the way, about finance. it has so many different ways you can be good. Not just one. There's just so many different dimensions to being good at it.
Next question.
When you were talking about your the recovery theory, I was thinking you're using the OTC options market to represent, so to speak, the equities market, and I just wonder, you know, how representative is the OTC options market of the underlying equities market? It seems to me it's a whole different group of participants.
It is, but that's an empirical question. It's not a theoretical question. So when I'm done doing the recovery, we'll see if it works. But it is a different collection of people, but boy, are they greedy. You know, greed is my friend here, like Gordon Gekker, you know. These guys and gals are hunting out every little dollar they can find. If there was something they should know about the equity market that affects what they're doing and it's not being used, then someone will come along and make use of it, you know. So I have great faith in their hunger for profits, and that their hunger for profits will lead them to mirror the equity market for everything they need in that. But they make mistakes. I mean, I'm not so fond of San Francisco, so I began in the options market here with John Cox and Mark Rubenstein. We had we were floor traders. We actually had the chair on the Pacific Coast Options Exchange, which was the largest options exchange at the time. We had the chair there trading Levi Strauss options. And so anytime you bought blue jeans, we were happy, you know, so. And we had these wonderful mathematical models about how to trade these things. And so with some trepidation, but with great confidence, we put our first trade on. We had our model and we programmed it up and we were all ready to go. We put our first trade on. And I got this frantic call from Mark saying, you know, we've lost some money on our first. I said, what did we lose? $50,000. This was a long time ago. $50,000 is not a cheap amount of money now, but boy, let me tell you, it loomed. It was like I'm trading college tuitions for my kids for this, you know? This is really scary, you know? And I said, how could that happen? We had it all figured out. It turned out the guy on the floor, we communicated, had put the trade on backwards. He bought and sold opposite from what he should. So I learned two lessons from that. First, that I didn't want to be in that business. But most importantly, I learned you can't run a business from across the coast. I mean, you have to be right there, physically there, you know. So over the years, that's a hard lesson I've learned. But I can tell you from the models we built and the work we did, we really knew what was going on in the equity, and we wanted to know more about what was going on in the equities market. So I don't know, but I have confidence that it'll be okay.
Next question.
I was just wondering, in terms of the work you were doing, for other days that you've tested, is the relationship between historical probabilities and recovered probabilities about the same? And do you test to see whether they're different from each other?
It's a wonderful question, and I could lie and tell you an answer. But the truth is, I've only done one day. It took me months to do that one stupid day. It just takes a long time, you know, because the data is fraught with so many problems. You know, you don't get a surface. What you get is, well, there's a three-month 20% option, and then there's a 8-month, and this one was traded by Credit Suisse, and that one was traded by Morgan Stanley. So you've got all these points that are fluctuating, and you've got to fit a surface. And the surface has to be really nice, because those things I was showing you, those little triangles, those are the difference between two options. That's a second derivative. It's just really a horrible thing. And, you know, this is, it's like that old, I think it was Yogi Berra said, in theory and practice are the same, but in practice they're different. Yeah. That's what's happening. So I'll let you know, we're trying desperately to get all the days done. Okay. I mean, I'll tell you this. I'll be surprised if that shape differential isn't changing over time. I expect to see some important times when the market is more confident than history and less confident than history. Yeah.
Next question.
Okay, another question.
I'm a little unclear from your presentation, maybe because of the way the notation got a little messed up, on what the generative...
Messed up? You mean non-existent?
What is the underlying price process here that has this property that the real world, rather than the risk-neutral probabilities, can be recovered from the option prices?
There's no... The underlying process is actually pretty straightforward. There's really only kind of... I think two basic assumptions and one kind of cleaning up assumption. So one assumption is that it has this, since you talk about risk, it has this Markovian feature to it.
Okay.
That if you're in a state today, you're going to have a fixed probability of going to another state, and that probability isn't changing much over time. It could change over time, but over 2 years or 3 years, it's not going to change very much. I don't think that's a bad assumption because I think the world is Markov. If you make the states rich enough, you get it. So it becomes an empirical question whether the states that I can look at for options are rich enough. Mm-hmm. And then the second assumption is that there's this risk aversion. Mm-hmm. You know, and so it's really that the risk aversion doesn't depend on going from one state to another. It depends on the state you end up in and the state you start in, just the ratio of the two. And that fits all the basic models we use, so I didn't think it was too heroic an assumption. Let me give you, the biggest problem here is using options, getting enough information. So there's a lot of work going on now to do this in fixed income. So you have a state, and what's the state today for the bond market? Well, it's pretty comfortable to say you've got a short interest rate and you've got a long interest rate, okay? Or a short rate and a long futures rate, you know? So I know the short rate today is about, depending on the time, about 1%, and long rate's about 4%, let's say that, okay? 1 in 4, or 0.5% in 4. And so the whole model gets strung out. That's the stake. If you ask, so what's the world today? I'm telling you what short rates and long rates are gonna be. And they're gonna move over time in some way, some random way. It's gonna transit from 1% and 4% to 2% and 3% to the curve will flatten or it'll steepen or rise or fall. So that's what I model. What do we have options on? Well, we have swaptions. So think of a state, it's a square. So this is the short rate and that's the long rate. All right? And you know where you are today in that square. And you want to figure out, how do I get to these different places? What's the probability of moving up or down? You could define a crash in terms of interest rates just as you do in terms of equity markets. So I want to know how I move there. But I have to have options on every state. And a state is a point there. And what do I have options on? I have swaptions. So I can have options on the short rate, and I can have options on the long rate. All right? So what's an option on the short rate going to be? It's going to be giving me the price of being in one of those columns where the short rate is something. And what's an option on the long rate going to be? It's going to be giving me the price of being on one of those rows. But I don't get to get the intersection. If I buy the two of them, I'm getting a row and getting a column. I'm not getting a point there. And I can have spread options. That gives me a diagonal. So I just don't have options that are just precisely what I want. Right? That's going to be the challenge in fixed income. And so the way we get around that is we say, well, we're going to make some assumptions about smoothness and just how it deteriorates. You know, we have to add some other stuff to it. But we'll be able to do it then.
If I can follow up just real quickly, so the key issue that makes this special is not the time and homogeneity of some sort of Markov chain, but rather it's the fact that the risk aversions are different from state to state and that they may be time varying as well, right?
I can't do it. Now, when you say key, I know that those are sufficient conditions, but I can't guarantee you that they're necessary. Mm-hmm. So being a finite number of things isn't necessary at all.
But in particular, like going from 100 to 110, an investor may react differently than going 10% above 110, okay, which would be quite a little...
Yeah, and I account for that. I allow that.
Yeah, okay.
But if it wasn't that way, it'd be even easier to do it. See, I mean, all that matters is that 110, 120, 130, 140, those are all treated differently. What and I don't care about percentages, but what I care is that the move from 100 to 110 doesn't depend upon the path, the movement. It just depends. I ended up at 110 and I started at 100. Okay? That's the only critical thing. It is, if you're steeped in black scholes and binomial, it's hard to see why this works. You know? It certainly was hard for me to see for a long time. Now I've convinced myself that it worked, but I have a vested interest in convincing myself that it works. It's been vetted by others, so I'm sure it works. Other questions? See, this is the two-stage audience, I said. It's clear that you've been doing this stuff for a while, and it's not clear that other people have, so that's the difference. Yeah?
I'll kind of ask an in-between question.
And I'm not sure you can really answer this. You alluded to the likelihood or certainly the potential of regulatory changes on OTC option trading. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah. You know, in my business, this is what we do. We trade these things a lot. We're not active traders, but we take large positions. And so it's really critical to us to know what's going to happen. So in the course of trying to figure it out, we've paid lawyers and all sorts of folks to tell us what will happen, and we can't get an answer. Now, I can tell you that living in a world where the regulations are severe is a much better world to live in than a world in which you don't know what they are. So this uncertainty about what the regulatory implementation of something like Dodd-Frank is going to be is a huge inhibitor. So when I showed you that the curve serves up because there's trillions of dollars of demand at the far end for long-dated options, one of the reasons it's starting to, that you've got a lot of steepness in it, and in the past month or two, for a variety of reasons, the steepness has gotten to the highest levels it's ever been at. The difference between the five-year vol and one-year vol is higher than it's ever been. And the question is, why has it gotten so high? Well, part of the reason is there's a euphoria that drops down short rates. But another part of the reason is that that far end is supplied by investment banks and commercial banks. And they're finding it very difficult to keep long-dated options on their books. If one of the one of the implications of this is the Volcker Rule. So under the Volcker Rule, they're supposed to separate, indeed not really engage in trading for profit. You're not supposed to run a hedge fund if you run a bank. You know, you're supposed to be a provider of services to the market and provide liquidity to the market. But what does it mean to say, I'm selling you a five-year option and I'm hedging against it and I'm trying to build a profit in for myself, and how can I tell the difference between that and selling a five-year option to anybody and trying to make a profit? How can I tell the difference between taking a position to make profits or taking a position to accommodate the market? So that uncertainty about how that's going to be ruled, coupled with the constraints on capital that they face, means that the supply at that far end is less than it was. Conversely, those folks at the far end are now coming down a little bit. So what you were doing when you had to buy a five-year, when you're seeing the price differential between five-year and four-year, you're coming down to four. At the same time, some of the hedge funds are saying, we can come in. Like we do, we're supplying that. We can provide some supply there. So there's an equilibrium that's being sought out. But even trying to find that equilibrium when you don't know what the regulations are going to be is very hard. And I can't really tell you what they're going to be. And I'm quite comfortable that no one can. They can give you an opinion, but no one really knows. Okay? This is a bad place for us to be in. And it's not good for the competitive position of this country in this industry, because I can assure you that for all the talk in Europe and even in Asia about, well, we want to synchronize regulations around the globe, those folks are just licking their chops, the idea that the U.S. won't get its act together, and I can assure you they're not going to take the same kinds of actions. Thank you very much.